here today. We're going to program this simple pawn game using JavaScript and HTML. But we have some coding to do, so without any further ado, let's start coding our application. Let's start here by creating a new file called pawn.html or whatever, and in here just grab some basic HTML, set the title to pawn, whatever, and set a script tag to the body, or add a script tag to the body. So we can start off by declaring a width and height of the application, and in this example, let's use 700 pixels for the width and 600 pixels for the height. I also like to keep a static reference here to the method pi constant, using this lowercase pi variable for convenience. And to update our game state, we need a canvas and a key state. Sorry, a canvas, a content, and a key state. And for our logic, do we need a player, the AI, and the ball objects, like that. So now I'm just writing out the skeleton functions here for games. So we need a main function, an init function, update function if I figure out spacing, and lastly a draw function, I guess, like that. And at the end there, just make sure you call the main function so the game will actually kick off, start. So we can create our canvas here, so document.create element canvas, like so, and let's set the width of canvas, so canvas a width equals the width we declare, and the height here to the height we declare. Now just grab the context from canvas, a 2D context that is, so context 2D, and let's append it to the body of the document. So document body dot append child canvas. Then just call the init function and create this help function here that I like to call loop, like so. And in here we just call the update the draw functions. Then we just use the window request animation frame for our game loop to update here. So we'll take the loop function and the canvas element as arguments there. So we can start by initializing our player, AI, and ball. And they're all pretty similar here at the start, so we can do all of them at once. So they will all have X field for the X position at canvas, or in the canvas, and a Y field for the Y position. And we will have an update method and a draw method. And draw method are pretty much identical in all of them since all are drawn as rectangles. So we just do this fill rectangle method here and the X and Y position like so. And then we just have the width and the height here as two fills. So for the player and AI, just the width to 20 pixels and the height to 100 pixels. And since the ball is drawn as a perfect square, it will only need one length there, the side length, and that will be used for both the width and the height here, like that. So if we now go down here to the knit and set the start position of all of the elements here, so the player will be offsetted from the left side of the canvas by the width of the player, and the Y position will be centered at the middle of the canvas here, so that's just the height minus the player dot height divided by 2, like that. And for the AI X position, we'll offset that from the right side by the player, the width, and the, you can actually do it like this, plus the AI dot width, like that. And then for the Y position, it's the same as the player, so we just do like so. And for the ball, we'll just be centered in both directions, so ball of side divided by 2 for the X position, and the Y position is just the height minus the ball dot side length divided by 2. So now if we go down here to update the draw and just call player.update, AI.update, and plus the ball.update, I guess, and then change all of those here to draw. And if we open this up at the browser, we should hopefully see this picture drawn for us. But as you can see here, I have this inverse team going, where I draw the paddle and the balls in white and the background in black. So let's do that for our application as well here, or our game. So let's go back to Sublime Text, and yeah. So we can just do a fill rect here, the 0, 0, the width and the height, like so. Let's set the fill style to white, like that. But before we do that, let's actually updated, guys. So we can do some updating. Let's start with player here. So we need for that, we need a key state of capturing key state. And we just add event listeners to the body here to capture them. So key down event, we want to call this event callback function like so. And then we have the key up. So in the key down, we want just want to set the event.key code here to true, like that, and in the output a while here, and then in the when we release a key, we want to delete that post or that that key value pair in the JavaScript object. So we just want to delete the key code here, so like that. So if you go to the top here and just set some key values or key codes here, so we have the up arrow as 38 and the down arrow as 40, and then we just update here accordingly. So we say if key state up arrow, then we want to subtract from the y value, let's say 7 pixels, and when the down arrow is pressed here, so we want to add to the y value. So for now, I should be able to control player paddle. Yeah, that seems to be the case here. So that's good. So now we can do the ball update. So for that, it will need a new field here that I will call velocity, or bell for short here. And I set it to null at start here, and then the speed value, I'll say that's 5 for now, like that. And then in the init method, just make sure you set the initial velocity for the ball here. So it equals to the x, we can set that to 0 for now, and then the y velocity to the ball.speed, like that, and hopefully now the ball should be going downwards. Oh, sorry, we need to update this here, so we just want to update the x position, so this of x plus equals this of velocity of x, and the y position with the y velocity, like that, and now the ball should be going downwards. Yeah, so we need to listen here. If the y position is less than 0, or bottom, the bottom of the ball here, so this dot y plus this dot side, if that is bigger than the height, then we just want to mirror the y velocity, so this velocity of y times equals x to 1, and that should give us a bounciness here, collision with the edge of the canvas. But if you put some ridiculous number value here, so let's say for example 50, you can see that the ball is going inside of the canvas border. And to fix that, do we need to calculate the offset? And that is of course depending on which direction the ball is going. So we set, and for that we can just use this ternary operator. So we can say this dot velocity dot y is less than 0. So if the ball is going upwards, then we just want to take the 0 minus this of y to calculate the offset. Else, do we want to take the height minus this dot y plus this dot psi, like that. And then we just add the offset to the y position, so we have y plus equals the offset. And that now you can see that the ball is going all the way to the end of the canvas here. But it's actually not a perfect elastic collision here. So to fix that, since some of the velocity is lost inside of the border here, we take 2 times the offset to fix that, and we now have an elastic collision that is perfect or fit well for this example game here. Yeah, so that's good. So that's it for the y collisions, and let's put this back to, let's say, 5 for now. And before we go any further here, let's just center the canvas here. So doing that, we just set the position to not static, to absolute, and then the margin to auto, and then just by setting the position attributes here to 0, it will center it in most of the browsers. So to write to 0 like that, and now we have the canvas centered. So we can do the collisions here. So we do it like by setting the velocity here to the x, and now the ball should be on the right. And to check if it hits a box here or rectangle, we need a helper function in the update method of the ball here. So x position, a y position, a width and a height of the first bounding box, and then the same for the other one, so b.x, b.y, b.w, and b.h. And then I could go into the math here, but for now I will just show it for you here. So it will just return ax is smaller than the bx plus bw, and ay is smaller than the by plus bh, and bx is smaller than the ex plus aw, and by is smaller than bay plus ah. So this will just return true if two boxes are if they intersect, else it will return false. And then, so we doesn't need to check against both of the paddles, since we are just interested in the right paddle when the ball is going to the right, and the left paddle when the ball is going to the left. We can use that ternary operator here as well, so we can just say the paddle equals to this double zero, you know, x is smaller than zero. So if it's going to the left this time, then we want to check against the player. I also want to check against the AI paddle. Now we can just say if AA BB intersect of the paddle of x, paddle dot y, paddle dot width, and paddle dot height. So if that intersect with the bounding box that is this dot x, this y, this dot side, and this dot side, like that. So if they intersect, then we also want to mirror the x velocity. I like that. And for now, the ball should be bouncing back and forth between the paddles. And if I miss the paddle here, the ball should be going out of the canvas. Yeah. So, but this is a bit boring, since it doesn't depend on where on the paddle I hit the ball. The ball will just go in this elastic collision between back and forth between the paddles. So to do it a bit more fun, we could calculate the height normal. So, or the normalized value on where on the paddle the ball hits. So to do that, that's quite simple. I just call it n here. We will just take the the y position of the ball plus the side length minus the paddle dot y, and then just divide that by the paddle dot height plus this dot side. So that will give us the normalized height offset, that so a value between 0 and 1 on where on the paddle the ball hits. And then we could use that value to calculate the reflection angle that I was called 5 now. And that is calculated by taking 2 times the n minus 1. So this will give us a value between positive 1 and negative 1. So then we can just multiply this by an angle in radians. So 0.25 times pi, that's the same as pi over 4, that is the same as 45 degrees, if you're not that familiar with radians. So it will give us a 45 degrees reflection angle when it's hitting at the top here, and a negative 45 degrees angle up when it hits on the top of the paddle, and a positive 45 degrees angle when it's at the bottom of the paddle. And then we could just update the velocity accordingly here to the, so we can say this dot speed times math dot cosinus of that angle, and then we could just take the y velocity to this dot speed times math dot sinus of that angle, like that. And as you can see now, it won't work, but if we use this value, or actually when it's hitting the right, it should go to the left, but this will give us a value between 0 left to do, so let's do the AI now. And we'll just use a very simple AI, not very smart or anything. So we'll just calculate our destination on the y-axis where we want to go here. So that is just the ball.y minus this.height plus, minus ball.size divided by 2, like that. So that will also times 0.5. So that will give us the y position of the y-axis the ball wants to go to. So now if you set this dot y equals to the destination position, the paddle should follow the ball here at all times. So yeah, you can see here. But that's a bit boring since we won't be able to beat the AI. It is impossible. So to do that, we could just use this flashy way of doing stuff. So we just subtract by the y value, and this should be it. We just add this here, and then we multiply this by a small number, let's say 0.2. And that should make it possible for us to theoretically beat the AI here. Yeah, so now we can see that it isn't reflecting a straight line from the AI anymore. Well, now it was, but yeah, you get the point here. But I guess that's a bit too fast here, so we should change that to 0.1. And let's increase the speed here to 12. And yeah. And I should be able to beat the AI. So yeah, now for then. Well, let's add a smashing system to the game. So if we can say if the absolute value of the angle is bigger than some value, let's say 0.2 radians. So we take the absolute value here of the angle and check if that is bigger than 0.2 pi here, so about 36 degrees, I guess. If that's the case, we won't set the smash value to 1.5, else we won't set it to 1. And then we can just multiply that smash value at the start here. So if we hit, I screwed up here. This should of course be pi. Yep, so if I hit on the top here, the ball should be smashing. So let's see if that's the case. Let's hit it. Yeah, there, you can see that the AI smashed there, and there I smashed. And here you can see that I could win over the AI. So that's good. So we have just, one thing here left to do is maybe to check if the X position is smaller. If that is smaller than 1 or 0, or the X position is bigger than the width of the application, then of course we want to set the start direction and all that again. So let's go down here to the init. Let's just copy this. Let's copy it in here for now. Like that. So now if I hit it, yeah, that's good. And we will of course want the X velocity here to be depending on who the paddle is. So we can just use the same thing as we did here. Let's copy this. Take it down here. Add it like that. And I'll see if that's the case. Yep. But this can be a bit abusive. So you can see if I just stay here, I will always get a point. So to get rid of that, so to speak, bug or exploit, you could add a surf function to the paddle, and that should be the last thing to do here. So let's do that. So let's add a surf function here at the top, and as a parameter, it will take which side the ball should be going. So 1 if it should be going to the right, and -1 if it should go to the left here. And for this, we just take a random value between 0 and 1 here that I was equal to the map of random. And then we set the X position depending on the side. So if the side is 1, then we, and so if the probably do a second video of this where I add a score system. But I guess this video is longer enough here. And yeah, so I hope I see you then. And thank you. Yeah, so I just realized that you could go outside of the border with the paddle and the AI. And to finish that, that's really simple. That's just one line of code to add to the update functions of the player and the AI. So let's do that real quick here. So just go down here to the ball.update. The AI.update and the player.update. And here we can say this.y equals math.max of math.min. And like that. So that the maximum value can only be 0. So that would stick it to the top of the canvas. And the minimum value will of course be the y value or the height minus this.height. Like that. So that should restrict it to be only inside of the canvas. And I realized I had one thing here in the serve function. So you could just add the width. You should add the width of the player.